June and I in our meetings actually have relatives down around Houston and Dallas.
Okay. We want to pray for all the people in Texas right now.
What did you do? Dawn Harris.
Dawn Harris.
Has Charles, did Charles Burns family from Meville? He was a gentleman that was here with Harris at some.
Charles Burns.
Charles Burns family.
Judy Rosario Adams just found out that she has breast cancer.
Can I just say Judy Adams?
Judy Adams. He's gonna say Judy, God knows.
I know, I know. I'm not even trying to pronounce it.
And my husband went, left a position at the jail, and he got full-time through EMT, and he loves it. There's just a little, he says, oh, we're fine, but I do all the thinking with the finances, and I know we will be fine because God always finds a way. Just ease me of my anxieties would be great.
Pray for Tina and anxiety.
Travis, worship for students going back to college. Also, we have already mentioned our bus driver teachers and students going back to high school. Also, Calvin versus for Laura, we have heard that today. Come this afternoon.
Got it.
Hey, okay, brother.
Families of those missing on that ship.
Let's go to prayer. Gracious and Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this day that you made just for us. And we thank you for giving us another opportunity to enjoy your creation and serve you. And Father, we want to take this time to just lift up our joys and thank you and praise you for answered prayer and for being able to celebrate anniversaries, being able to be part of a wedding on a naval ship, being part of the youth group and having such a committed youth group that is so active within our church. We thank you and praise you for family and friends, church family that responds to any of us who are hurting, who have had surgery, and who are trying to recover from any kind of illness. Father, we just thank you for how they respond and how they reach out to us to offer love and help and assistance. Father, we do praise you for the healing that you've done upon Craig, who had had heart surgery. And we also thank you for watching over and protecting us in each and every one of our days. And we do thank you for watching over Joe Burdett as a, you know, and her helping to keep that incident from being any worse than it was. Father, we all know it could have caused more damage to other property and it could have easily hurt or, you know, seriously injured someone. So we just thank you and praise you that for the way it happened and for watching over all of us, and including Joe. Father, we pray at this time for those that are traveling, those that are going back to college. We pray for those driving buses, the students that are going back to school, the teachers, the parents. Father, we pray for Lori Way, who's going to be traveling to our church here this afternoon to minister up to us in music. We pray for a safe travel for them to the church and also to home. Father, we pray for those families that are missing loved ones on that ship. Father, we pray at this time for all those names that have been mentioned in our Sunday schools, that are on our list, the names that are published each week in our bulletin. We just lift them up for your special healing at this time. And we also add to that list the names of Sarah, Courtney, Michael Bryson, Brock Roy, Dawn Harris, Judy Adams. And we pray also for Tina. We pray for your healing touch upon all these individuals. And we especially pray that you will give some peace and comfort to Tina as she handles the anxiety of a new job by her husband. And just let her know that things will be okay, and help her to have trust and faith in you that you will take care of things for her. And Father, we pray at this time for all the families who are grieving at this time. We especially lift up the Tom Garris family, the Charles Burns family, and the Melvin Nicewander family. Father, we pray for your strength and courage to be given to all those family members. Help them to get through this tough ordeal that they are going through right now. And we just pray for the peace and comfort that you always promise us when we cry out to you. So we just pray that you will anoint them with so much love and comfort at this time. Father, in a moment of silence, we are going to take a period of time and lift up our unspoken requests at this time. Father, we thank you and praise you for what your Son has done for us, for making that ultimate sacrifice on that cross and freeing us and liberating us from sin. And then 3 days later, he paved the way for our eternity. Father, we thank you and praise you for that. And we also thank you and praise you for that prayer that he taught us so long ago. And let us close this prayer praying that prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thy is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now, if I could have the children come down.
Good morning. Moses it seems like that's where God always descended from heaven to talk to Moses. Well, anyway, the Israelites, they were just wandering all that time in the desert, and now they're camped in the desert, and you know, that's how we feel sometimes when we're in a place where we don't, you know, it's not our home, it's strange to us, and it's a wilderness, and sometimes we wander. But who can we depend on? Exactly. No matter where we're at, no matter how lost we are, we can depend on God to help us through that. And that's what I want you guys to do. Always remember. Don't ever forget. You can always cry out to God, just like the Israelites did so many times. They cried out for help to God as well. We do the same thing. So let's always remember to do that. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for Scotty and Mitchell and Brendan. Father, we just lift them up to you for your care, your protection, and your guidance. And we pray that we know that we're all going back to school this week. And Father, we just pray for their first day back to school to go well. And we pray for the teachers, the staff, the bus drivers, and the parents also. We pray this in Jesus' name. Linda's going to pass out to you guys.
Lollipops.
If you have your Bibles with you and you would like to follow along, our scripture lesson comes again, once again, from the book of Exodus, Chapter 19, verses 1 through 9a. Chapter 19, verses 1 through 9a. And if you're looking for A in your Bible, it's not there. Okay? A means it's the very first verse of that verse. Okay? So we're not reading the whole verse. Just for your own information. Exodus 19, 1 through 9a. Let us hear God's word for us today. On the third new moon after the Israelites had gone out of the land of Egypt, on that very day they came into the wilderness of Sinai. They had journeyed from Rephidim, entered the wilderness of Sinai, and camped in the wilderness. Israel camped there in front of the mountain. Then Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the Israelites, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples. Indeed, the whole earth is mine, but you shall be for me a priestly kingdom, and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the Israelites." So Moses came, summoned the elders of the people, and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. The people all answered as one, "Everything that the Lord has spoken, we will do." Moses reported the words of the people to the Lord. Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to come to you in a dense cloud, in order that the people may hear when I speak with you, and so trust you ever after." These are the words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we've heard your word that you have chosen for us today, and for that we do give you thanks. And Father, I thank you and praise you for this message that you have given to me to share with your people. And Father, I always pray that my actions and my words will always be pleasing and honorable to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we are continuing our sermon series on Adam Hamilton's book, Moses, the Reluctant Prophet. Following God God's miraculous victory over the Egyptian army at the Red Sea crossing, the Israelites can now celebrate their newfound freedom. They now begin following Moses into the wilderness back to Mount Sinai, where he met his wife Zipporah, and where he first encountered God. Their trip would take 3 months from the time they left Egypt, covering 190 miles. Approximately 1 month after the miracle of the manna, they would make camp at the foot of Mount Sinai for the next 11 months. And during those 11 months, Moses would make many trips up and down Mount Sinai, meeting God, who descends to the mountaintop to speak to Moses. The meetings between Moses and God, Adam Hamilton says, they would converse face to face, like two people talking to each other. He says in his book that Mount Sinai is the setting for chapters 19 through 40 in Exodus, all of the book of Leviticus, and chapters 1 through 10 in Numbers. In our Exodus passage, Mount Sinai becomes the place to meet God. Even centuries later, the prophet Elijah also returns to Mount Sinai in hopes of meeting God. Adam says that thousands of pilgrims each year hike up Mount Sinai, also hoping to meet God. And this was our hope as well, as we hiked up that mountain during our visit. You see, Moses' reunion with God at the top of Mount Sinai served several important purposes. First of all, it was to remind and reinforce to Moses and Israel of God's sovereignty over his creation. Secondly, God wanted to reaffirm to Moses and Israel that as the chosen people, they will be expected to live by his moral standards. And lastly, God informs Moses and Israel about his plan to follow through with his promise to Abraham, affirming that Israel is indeed the covenant people. In verse 4, God reminds Moses of what he did to the Egyptians and how he bore them on eagle's wings, liberating them from slavery in Egypt. You know, oftentimes a mother eagle will push her young out of the nest in order to teach them to soar and fly. And their first attempts is really ugly. They're just really clumsy, and they usually fail. And as they're fluttering and struggling and falling in the air, the mother swoops down underneath them, gathering them in her strong wings, and takes them back to safety, back to solid ground. Many mammals in the wild are pushed within minutes after birth, based on and for survival. The wildebeest in Africa, they're a migratory animal. And when wildebeests are born, they learn to run within 30 minutes of birth so that they can keep up with the herd. Because if they don't keep up with the herd, a predator will get them. This is what God did for the Israelites. He pushed Moses and the Israelites firmly upon their birth of freedom from the Egyptians, trying to assure their spiritual survival, increasing their faith and their trust in him. God reminds Moses of the miracles he performed for them while they were in the wilderness. He reminds Moses of the Red Sea crossing, the bitter water that was made sweet, the miracle of manna, and the water that was obtained from that rock. God reminds Moses and the Israelites how he protected them, how he took care of them, and how he supported them on his broad and strong wings. God, as creator of everything, didn't just act in the Israelites' lives while they were held in slavery. He remained in control of their destiny even after they left Egypt. God reminds Moses and Israel that he is the king, the supreme ruler, and that there is no other who will look after them as he did and will continue to do so. God's sovereignty also permits him to establish rules, laws that his people will be required to follow and live by. God says to Moses, "Now therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples." God's sovereignty allows him to claim the right to place demands upon the Israelites in return for them gaining favor with God. Commands that form the boundaries of the covenant laws, they will be required to live under. In this manner, God not only assures his supremacy as ruler and leader over his chosen people, but also his creation as well. God's sovereignty is also exemplified in our lives as well. God has always and continues to rule and interact with his people from his throne in heaven. We just had praises of answered prayer today. We've been praising God for answered prayer for weeks, for several months. All of us are deceived and thinking we are in control of our lives. I think I was pushing on it too hard. I'll even keep my hands off of it. We are just kidding ourselves with that kind of thinking. God has always been and still is in control of his creation. God maintains his sovereignty in our lives in many ways. We confirm his sovereignty when we refer to him with names like Most High, King, Lord, God Almighty, and Father in Heaven. We see God's sovereignty in the world we share with one another each and every day we live to serve him. We feel God's sovereignty through his miraculous actions, answering our prayers, answering our pleas. We experience his sovereignty through his redemptive action upon our lives and the lives of others around us. God's sovereignty hasn't changed at all. It's the same today as it was yesterday. God informs Moses that if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession of all the peoples. God has just offered the covenant he made with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to Moses and the Israelites. This is indeed why God wanted to liberate Israel from Egypt in the first place. The Mount Sinai event was to prepare Moses and the Israelites to receive God's laws. These rules that they will be required to live by will include, but not be limited to, the Ten Commandments and the Book of the Covenant. God says in this verse, if you obey me and my laws, you will become my treasured possession. Adam Hamilton writes that God would consider them his most precious possession, and they would become a kingdom, represent God, and mediate God's word. Mediate God's word, God's purposes, God's grace to the rest of the world. That is why God freed Israel from Egypt. That is why God frees and liberates us from sin. The salvation of Israel and us enrolls us into ministry. We become priests. You don't have to be called to drop everything in your life to be called into ministry. Ministry encompasses every service and sacrifice, small or large, that is done for the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus Christ. We have become God's representative, living our lives in constant relationship with Christ, always reflecting the love of neighbor and spiritual discipline that Christ showed us when he walked the earth. How do you measure up? We are to be God's messenger, proclaiming the gospel to our neighbor who hasn't yet heard it, sharing and explaining God's purpose in our lives and the lives of others. How do we measure up? We are not just expected to, but we are obligated as a result of our salvation to share the Lord's grace to all who are willing to listen. Folks, we must never forget that God liberated us from the bondage of sin for the same reasons he liberated Israel from the bondage of slavery. Number one, to have a lasting relationship with him. And two, to put those he possesses to work for his purpose. That which is making known his unlimited grace to the world. How do you measure up? Moses now goes to the elders and informs them of God's commands. And the people say in unison, "Everything that the Lord has spoken, we will do." Is that true? Did they do everything the Lord spoke? Do we do everything the Lord speaks to us? The people of Israel had beautiful, beautiful intentions. They agreed to live by the conditions of that God is going to soon give them. He hadn't even told them what the laws were, but they said, "We're going to do it."